praise the Lord, singing like that. We look forward to that precious day. Lord will gird himself in service and sweet manner. Good to be home in the kingdom of heaven. Walk on this earth complete. While we're still on this earth, though, we have scripture memory we're going through here. Now, you remember last month we remembered the scripture in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 9:6, where the angels spoke for the angels. I'm getting ahead of myself. The Holy Spirit spoke through the prophet Isaiah, and he uttered that prophecy, "Unto you a child is born, unto you a son is given." It was 700 years before that came to pass. But this morning, we see of the very day, Christmas Day, that prophecy was fulfilled. There in the book of Luke, the second chapter, the 11th verse, is on the screen now. "For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." This being a fulfillment of the scripture we studied last month. Good to be here. Good that we can look at this scripture. Know that our name's been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. One day we'll join it. So let us say that in unison now, Luke 2:11. "For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Our dear most gracious loving Heavenly Father, Lord, we do praise your precious holy name. Lord, we're grateful for the love that you have for us. Grateful, Lord, that you sent your Son to this earth to give his life on the cross of Calvary, that we might have the gift of eternal salvation. And Lord, with Christmas having just passed, Lord, that scripture just being fulfilled, we praise your precious name for it. Lord, may we live our lives in such a manner as to bring honor and glorification to your precious holy name. Look to you for divine guidance and direction. We pray your blessings upon the First Baptist Church of Gun Barrel City. Lord, you'd use this church mightily to serve you. Once more, honor and glory yours. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, thy beloved Son. Amen. We're going to have a special prayer request now also. Suzette Brown, if you know Suzette Tobin, my son-in-law, it's his mother. She's been taken up to the emergency room here at Gun Barrel. She has severe chest pain, severe pain in her arm, and they're concerned about her. I'm fixing to go up there and pray with her, as a matter of fact, but let's have prayer here at this time, please. Our dear most gracious loving Heavenly Father, Lord, once more we come to you in prayer. Lord, we do pray for Suzette. Lord, she has that pain in her chest. Lord, her arm, Lord, doesn't look good. We pray your hand upon her. Lord, we pray that you would watch over her. Lord, this would heal, your precious holy name glorified. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, thy beloved Son. Amen.
I want you to think about something before we continue our singing. How many of you have, does anybody do this anymore? Do you set resolutions for the new year? Anybody do that? Anyway. Oh, I see a hand. Yes, I see that hand. Bless you. But anyway, let's think about this. Seriously. The next song we'll sing, "I Will Serve You, God. I Will Serve You." As we begin this new year, what are some things you could do with our church, within our church? What can you do? There's lots of things going on. There's children that have, there's ministry to children you can be involved in, thinking of vacation Bible school, right? There's lots of things in the children's area. The youth, Brother Tony, would love for you to be involved. What's a way you could serve? Maybe it's just praying. For youth. I know there's a lot of the adults here that pray for our youth consistently. That's a way to serve. Maybe there's something that he could use you in the youth department. We have choirs. We have instruments, that we need more instruments playing. We need more choir members. You say, well, that's a good group. Yes, that's a good group. But wouldn't it be wonderful to see every chair filled within our choir loft? We have the choirs that need bodies and instruments. And then there's maintenance. I want to applaud those that every Sunday after our service, morning and night, they're walking around picking up and tidying up. That's such a wonderful service to our church. There's other things, maintenance. Brother LL could use some help with maintenance around the church. There's just all kinds of things that you can serve God within this body right here at this church. As we sing this song, be thinking about those things. As we continue within the year, be thinking about those things and find places that you can serve your Lord, your Savior, right here in this church. Let's sing together, I Will Serve Thee.
You have given life to me. I tell you what, that was good, Brother Teddy. We missed you while you was gone, too. Turn, if you will, in your Bibles to Ezekiel this morning. Ezekiel. Boy, look at all those children. And, well, some adults, children, too. Good to see so many children in our church. Ezekiel chapter 22. What's wrong with us? Starting out the new year, it's pretty good to look at ourselves and see just where we are. Ezekiel gives a warning here to Jerusalem. In verses 23, it starts like this. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, say to her, You are a land that is not cleansed, nor rained upon in the day of indignation. The conspiracy of her prophets in her midst are like a roaring lion tearing the prey. They have devoured people. They have taken treasure and precious things. They have made many widows in her midst. Her priests have violated my law and profaned my holy things. They have not distinguished between the holy and the unholy, nor have they made known the difference between the unclean and the clean. And they have hidden their eyes from my Sabbaths, so that I am profaned among them. Her princes in the midst are like wolves tearing the prey to shed blood, to destroy people and get dishonest gain. Her prophets plastered them with untempered mortar, seeing false visions and divining lies for them, saying, Thus says the Lord God, when the Lord has not spoken. The people of the land have used oppressions, committed robbery, mistreated the poor, needy, and they wrongfully oppressed the stranger. So I sought for a man among them who would make up a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. I love that passage of Scripture because it tells us exactly what we have done in America today and where we're going. Ask yourselves, where are we going? Or what's wrong with us today? Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the reading of the Word of God. And Lord, today as we stand here and proclaim the Word, Lord, I pray that you'll minister to us, each one as we need, in our own heart. And God, will listen to your Word very prayerfully and thoughtfully, that you might speak to our hearts. Let us open up the heart and the eyes of our understanding, that we might be enlightened today. And God, we give you the praise, for it's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. This is bad news, isn't it? Most everything is bad news when you turn on the television today. It all seems kind of bad. You know, I love the good news, bad news jokes. And I was trying to think of one of them that I hadn't used before, but I don't know if I have any that I hadn't used before. But maybe you haven't heard this one. I like this one pretty good because it seems to fit a lot of us. See how it goes now. About an old farmer. He had a pretty good sized farm, and he comes in, his face is kind of down, and he sits down at his the desk in front of the banker there, and he says, Mr. Banker, he says, you know that $100,000 I borrowed from you last year to buy that tractor with? He said, yeah. He said, well, I got bad news. It's gone. He said, you know that barn I borrowed $200,000 to buy that barn with and put it up? Got bad news, Mr. Banker. It's gone. He said, you know that seed that I planted on the farm and I borrowed a couple of hundred thousand for all of that seed, and everything to get it all planted and everything, the cotton and the corn. Well, he said, you know, those locusts came through and ate all the corn. My cotton didn't make. It's gone. He said, you know, the fire that destroyed the barn also burned up the tractor and everything else in my home. It's all gone. He said, well, what is the good news? He said, I'm going to still do business with you. That's the way it is kind of here, you know. Jerusalem's lost everything. God had bad news for them from the very beginning in verses 1 through 12. They've sinned against God. They've shedded innocent blood. They've committed idolatry. The unjust treatment of the people, the widows and the children and those. They've desecrated the Sabbath. They, you know. Isn't that like what we do today or have in America today? Adultery on every hand and bribery, extortion, and different things we hear about in our everyday life. And I thought about this and I said, you know, the reason God says it's this way is the land is unclean. It hadn't been rained upon, unblessed. And I think about our America. I love America. Don't get me wrong. America is the greatest nation as far as I'm concerned on the face of the earth. And I think it's got some of the greatest people on the face of the earth. But you know, we've done wrong, haven't we? The Bible says all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we realize at first the problem is we're a bunch of sinners. But I'm also thankful of the good news that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's the good news. But with all the good news of that, we still disobey God's laws. And we still find that we sin, oh, a lot more, seems like, than as a country. Then we do good for God. And America needs to be reminded that we're kind of like the valley of dry bones over in chapter 37. Man, it's getting dry. When you have our Congress and Senate and everything fighting amongst themselves and they're looking out for what they want instead of what the people want, I believe, and they're willing to step further and further into lostness. And we see our country falling further and further away from God instead of going towards God. We're living in a nation that is very, very dry. And it's unclean. It's unclean. There hasn't been a heaven-sent revival in a long time. It's been a long time since I've seen men and women actually fall on their face before God and cry out to God. We've lost that vision of living a holy life before God and a pure life before God. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5, it says, know this, that in the last day perilous times will come. For man will be lovers of themselves and lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, man, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the presence and the power of God. and from which they turn away. Doesn't that sound kind of like us today? As I read this scripture, and I've read it and preached on it many times before, oh, it just makes me want to cry when I see what we're becoming. And I said, where is the problem, Lord? What's wrong with us? And then I read what's wrong with us in verse 26. Well, it starts out with the prophets in verse 25. There's a conspiracy amongst the prophets in the midst of like a roaring lion. Man, they're devouring people. You know, the prophets were done that says, thus saith the Lord. Those that are preaching God's word, you don't hear it anymore. You know, we don't preach what God's word says most of the time today. We've lost that religious or Christianity and turned to religious. We violated God's laws. We followed after our own way. The Bible strictly tells us that, you know, we're to honor God with our bodies, and we don't do that, do we? No. I couldn't believe it back last year when that guy stood up and said in the governor something about we ought to let babies be born and then kill them if we don't like it. You see, that doesn't sound like America that I know. There's nothing more precious than that little child. Man, I thought, how far have we fallen away from God? And you know, it's everywhere. It's not just way out on the West Coast, it's all over. Man, I tell you what, we see that we've fallen away from God. We don't stand up for the Word of God anymore about, you know, gambling. I know a lot of you probably buy lottery tickets, and I'm probably talking to some of you, but I won't lose any money there because I don't gamble. But let me tell you something. It's killing our America. It really is. Even though it may not be wrong in your eyes, I believe it's wrong in God's eyes, folks. God doesn't say go out and gamble. You know, living is not a gamble. We live by faith in the Son of God. My hope is built upon God, not what I'm going to get if I buy a lottery ticket. And then drinking, there's no place for that in the Christian life. You've heard it from Brother Bill. You've heard it from Brother Perry. It's just wrong. No, it doesn't say that in the Bible, maybe, but it gives us that idea that drunkenness is wrong. Folks, that's what the Bible says. Oh, well, preacher, I don't drink with just one. Don't lie to me about that. You see, we just dive further and further away from the Word of God. Humanism sweeps our land today. Humanism makes right man's laws right, and that's not right. It's God's laws, not man's laws. This is God's word. We have profaned God's holy things. It says that's what's wrong with the priest. They violated God's laws and profaned my holy things. Let me tell you something. This is the body, the temple of our God. I hear God's name used, and I'm sorry to say, by some ministers today, in ways that, you know, if I said that back when I was a kid, man, I wouldn't have woke up for 3 hours. Daddy would have put me out. You know, we didn't say things like that. I don't curse. I just don't do that. I try to stay away from anything that might sound like a curse word. Because that was not part of our household growing up, you see. And my preacher, when I grew up, he was a preacher that you didn't hear him curse. You didn't hear him tell off-color jokes. You see, you just didn't do that. But today we kind of take it lightly, don't we? And the priest, they said this, what's wrong with us? We're unclean, aren't we? We've been unclean for a long time. We're very dry. You know, I was talking to an inmate the other day. They can read the Bible in a prison, but you can't read it in school. Something wrong with that, isn't it? They find Jesus in the prisons. We got ministers to minister there. It's okay. But you can't do it in schools anymore. You know, prayers in Congress, man, they don't even hit the ceiling. Only when, you know, there's a crisis, and then they'll call on the name of God. But that's exactly what God is saying here to Jerusalem. The Jewish people, you call when you're in trouble, but you don't listen to me when you're not in trouble. In the local churches, oh, let me tell you something. They have little sanctity in the Christian community or in towns and communities anymore. When I grew up and you grew up, most of you grew up the same time I did, probably, you respected the church property, didn't you? Nobody's going to break in and steal anything from the church. Our church was never locked. We have to lock everything up nowadays and have security and everything like that because of the crime. You see? We saw some of that last week. It's ridiculous, but we've lost our respect in the communities. And it's not the people on the outside. It's the ones on the inside, Jesus says. God says here, the priest, you've allowed this to happen. You profaned my name. It means you polluted my name. Where are we going for this next year? What are we going to do to change things? You know, I might get in trouble for saying this, but you know, that's all right too. I don't want you to come inside these buildings, these walls. This is God's sanctuary. You know, this is His temple, but we come to worship here. You know, they had the temple in Jerusalem. They come to the temple. I don't think we ought to drink Cokes inside the building. You know, this is God's house. You can wait till you get to McDonald's to drink a Coke or eat chips or whatever. I know some people let them do that nowadays, selling hot dogs outside. That's all right. You know, no, it's not all right. We're lessening and lessening and lessening to where we're getting away from God altogether. If I want to be entertained, I can go to a football game or show. But we come here for what purpose? To learn about God. And the trouble is, God's not even in most churches anymore. It's kind of like the old man that came in, the deacons escorted him out, said, no, you can't come in here. And he threw him out of the church because he wasn't well-dressed enough. And he heard a voice saying, don't worry about it, sir. I'm the Holy Spirit, and they haven't allowed me in there in years. You see, we've lessened in the things of God. Where are we going this next year? What are we going to do this next year that's different from all the other years? I'm not talking about programs. I'm not talking about what we're going to do at a banquet or whatever. No, I'm talking about what are we going to do in our lives to put God back on the throne. You see, we've taken Him off the throne and put ourselves on the throne. And then it goes on, it says the princes, that's political leaders. Oh, I feel like we've been sold out a long time ago by our political leaders. They just want to stay in there, seem to pad their own pews, pockets, and everything else. They don't care what's done, you know. It's a sad situation in America. And I don't agree with everything going on. But listen, I pray for them because the Bible tells me to pray. I pray for my president. I pray for my Congress. But folks, I pray also for our churches, because I believe in our families, because I believe it starts with families, trusting God, living for God. I am resolved, we sing a while ago. That song's a beautiful, beautiful song about what we need to do, no longer to linger. I don't make any resolutions, but I'm going to be in church on Sunday. Now, I know I missed through Christmas. You know, that was hard. I felt like I let God down. I really did. I couldn't speak. I was sick. Rhonda says, I know you're sick. Stay home. She said, when you don't go hunting, you're sick. She said, we got back from Lano. We went down there for the men of her church, and we had some time together. I was sick when I went down there. I was sicker when I came home. But I got so bad that after that, you can ask Brother Tom and them, I didn't even go the rest of the season. My season was over because I was sick. Man, I just didn't want to go. But I wanted to come to church, and I wanted to be here among our people. And boy, when I missed, it hurt. I sat down there thinking, well, Brother Bill's preaching right now. Brother Teddy's singing a song right now. You know, you watch that clock. I know exactly what y'all do. So I felt like I was here, even though I wasn't. But I resolved in my heart to draw closer to God this year, folks. And yeah, I'm the preacher. I ought to be close to God, but you ought to also. We ought to do that. Coming to church, being a part of the church, acting interchanging with people and loving people and helping people and working with people. There's a place for everyone to do something for God this year. You know, he says, what's wrong with my land? I like this, the third time he says, the prophets again, untempered martyr. That means watered down, martyr. No wonder the bricks fall apart. They were cheating on the mixture of the mortar, and they're making the rains would come and wash the walls away, and they would crumble because they're weak and, you know, the mortar. The prophets were telling them, oh, everything's all right. We have preachers today that tell people, oh, everything's all right. God will forgive you. Go ahead. That ain't right, folks. It ain't right. God will forgive, but you just don't go out and do things just because he's going to forgive you. We've all been guilty of that, haven't we? We need to cry out against sin. And it's all through the Bible. When people sin, you pay the price. When a church sins, it pays the price. The Bible says, love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul. And some of us, we just don't, do we? We love the Lord just a little bit. We want to give him just a little bit. So maybe he will bless our families. And, you know, it don't work that way. You love him with all your heart. And whether he blesses you or not, you still love him. And that's the reason so many people are falling out of the church today. They come in and they sit down in the pew, and I had a guy tell me, well, you know, I'm going to try church for a little while and see how it works out. I've tried everything else. It's not that way. You don't try church. You don't try God. You put him into your life and you live, let him live through you. And I'll tell you, it's a whole different world when you give your life to God to use no matter how. There's going to be the up times in your life. Nobody stays on those mountaintops all the time. There's going to be the valleys. But the same God that you serve on the mountain is also going to be with you in the valleys. And that's what we need to preach. That's what we need to tell, that Jesus Christ is Lord. And you are to serve him no matter what comes your way. We studied about Paul today. Did you know what? He served no matter what. They threw him in prison, he served. They stoned him, he served. He didn't say, all right, God, I tried you, it didn't work out. Look where you got me. No, he rejoiced even in the prison. The preacher had so soft on sin here. They so watered down the message. Man, we don't need that. We need backbone in our churches. We need people that were solid in their Christian faith. You know, that you can call on to pray and you know that God's going to hear them because they're right with God. He tells us we need to put on the whole armor of God. And we don't do that, do we? Most of us get up in the morning, our feet hit the floor, and we take off out the door without ever praying, without ever seeking God's face about anything. And our nation is crumbling around us today because God says, enough is enough. That's what he said here. I've had enough. God says, thou shalt not do it, and we do it, don't we? That's what he was telling them. You know, and the saddest thing is verse 30. God says, I sought for a man. He didn't say, I sought for a bunch of men. He said, I sought for a man. I believe that's a man or a woman or boy or girl among them that could make up a wall, fill in that gap where the hole was. And I found none. Folks, as I read that, I think, man, God is seeking for one person in his church who will commit themselves to God. And I said, God, why can't that be me? You know, Isaiah says, woe is me, Lord, for I am unclean. And I live amongst the people that are unclean. And I said, Lord, that's me. I'm unclean. I haven't done what I should be doing. And folks, we all do that, don't we? If you're honest with yourself, you're going to have to say, Lord, this is me. I haven't stood in the gap because I'm unclean. God says, I sought for one man who would make up the wall. You know, I believe God is searching for that one man or woman or boy or girl here today that will get on their face before God and say, Lord, I want to lead my family in the way that is right. Now, men, I got news for you. You're supposed to be the head of the house. If you're a husband and you got children, I believe God's going to hold you accountable for how you're leading those children. Wife, you're just as important. You're to work with him to lead your family. And oh, wouldn't it be nice this morning to start this new year with a husband and a wife joining hands in prayer, saying, God, our lives have been dry. Our lives have been unclean. We haven't done what you want us to do. And put your hands together with your husband and say, Lord, make us what we're supposed to be this year. Wouldn't it be great that you could do that? Maybe you're just a single parent. Oh, God's got a lot of responsibility for you. You know it. But with God, you can do it. Without God in your life, it's going to be tough. I tell you what, the church is here to help you. The church is here to pray with you. Help you out any way we can if you'll just call on us. But God is there waiting for you. And he's not going to answer your prayers until you get your life right with God. Maybe you're a teenager or a child. Oh, I'll tell you what. Many adults have been led to the Lord by a little child who says, "Daddy, why don't you go to church? What do you think about Jesus? Wouldn't it be good if you could lead them to the Lord if they're not?" I sought for a man who would stand in the gap, one with conviction in his life. That's what God is searching for. One with compassion in his life. One with courage in his life. It takes courage to stand up for God. It don't take much just to walk away, live out there in a world of sin. That's not being courageous. It takes courage to stand boldly for God in a land that's unclean. You'll be run off from some places, you'll lose some friends, but you'll have the greatest friend you'll ever need, and that's Jesus Christ. This morning, I'm going to ask you, where are you going? What are you doing this next year? Won't you take a stand for God? If you're ashamed to come down here with your wife and with your children, you're not going to go very far. I'm not saying you have to come down today. You can stay right where you are. But wouldn't it be nice to come down and just say with your wife, let's make a commitment to God to be in His house, to study His Word, to lead our children in the right direction. We want God to bless us. We want to be rained upon. It takes courage. It takes commitment. If you're willing to make that commitment, would you do it today? Some of you have never trusted Christ as Lord and Savior. The old devil's whispering to you all, you can't live that kind of life. And let me tell you something, you can't. But God can through you if you'll commit yourself to Him. Why don't you come today and say, "Preacher, I know I'm a sinner. I want to be saved. I want Christ to come into my life." The Bible says if you call upon the name of the Lord and you're serious in your heart, you're willing to repent of your sin, that means turn away from sin and start walking towards God. He will come in to your life and save you. Boy, it'd be the blessed time of your life. Maybe you're looking for a church home, and this is the place God's led you. I don't know why you haven't joined earlier, but, you know, this is the place God has led you. Would you come and say, "I want to commit myself to God. I want to work in this church with God. And I will do my best over this next year to preach the Word of God that He might bless you through it, that He might show us where we're making some big mistakes." You see, somebody said, "Well, preacher, you're always stepping on my toes." I'm always stepping on mine too. But if I wasn't, you know what I'd do? I'd quit. Because if you're not preaching the Word, you're not preaching. All other things are just, you know, that's out there. This is the only thing that will save a sinner, is Jesus Christ through this Word. Not me. I can't save it. Nobody else. The only way you can be saved is through Jesus Christ. Somebody said, "That's a pretty red shirt you got on." Well, I can't really tell if it's red or not, but I told him it reminds me of the blood of Jesus that covers my sin. Folks, every time I think of Jesus, I think about the blood that was shed for me. Would you come as we pray and sing? Don't wait for somebody else. You just come to the front, make your decision, and go back and be seated, okay? Heavenly Father, I thank you for these that are here today. I thank you for the people here. Lord, may we start this year off with a commitment to you and live that commitment every single day of our life. We give you praise, for it's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.